Very good morning to you. This is the South Africa Morning. Now, South Africa has become a lucrative market for the counterfeit industry. This is especially true in the retail clothing sector. Now, the local textile industry is worried about the impact that this is going to have on its dealings and its finances, as well as its sustainability. It also says that authorities are nowhere close to finding a real and sustainable solution. But let's discuss this with Simon Eppel from the SA Clothing and Textile Workers Union, or SACTU. Thank you so much for your time this morning, Mr. Eppel. So when we talk about counterfeit goods, what exactly are we talking about? Are we talking about knockoffs of well-known brands?
Yes, exactly. And I think that's a good point of departure for the conversation, because there are several elements to the problem. The first one is the counterfeit goods. It's those goods which are essentially well-known, maybe even domestic, but certainly local, certainly international brands, which have been illegally reproduced by some other party and then generally smuggled then into the country. So that's the first level of problem. But there's actually several other versions of this which affect our industry. The other one is the illegal importation of secondhand clothing, which actually shouldn't be coming into the country at all. We don't allow it into the country, except in exceptional circumstances. And the third one is the broader basket of illegal imports, products which are supposed to come into the country and pay some kind of a tax, and they end up coming in with no tax. And there's many consequences to all three of those. Essentially, they destroy our local industries and they rob the fiscus of income.
Which of these categories that you've just highlighted are actually impacting the South African clothing and textile industry per se? Because in my logic, I'm thinking, if you're buying a knockoff of a popular brand, that brand is most likely not being manufactured in South Africa. So it really wouldn't affect the industry per se. But if you're looking at the illegal imports and the secondhand clothing, my logic would take me there. Am I correct?
Your logic is wonderful. There are some sort of various permutations of that. So, in fact, we do have local manufacturers who produce for the international brands, and that's particularly the international sporting brands, some of the well-known ones, the Nikes, the Pumas, etc., Adidas's. So we do have local manufacturers in that niche. And they're competitive. They, you know, have crossed all the kind of ticks and checks for the big brands. But the largest part of our industry isn't in the big international brands. It's in domestic products. It's in the kind of everyday things that you would buy. And so you're right. The largest impact is from secondhand clothing, but predominantly the illegally imported products. Look, almost a couple of years ago, we did this study, and almost 40% of the products that were imported from China, which is by far our largest import destination, about 40% of those were illegally imported into the country. So this is an absolutely phenomenally large problem, not just in clothing and textiles. It's actually in many other sectors too. And what it does is it brings cheap goods into the country. It doesn't pay the tax on them through a variety of sort of tricks that are done. Those land in the country artificially deflated in terms of price. They then put local factories out of work. People lose jobs. Citizens become poorer. We have less spending power in the economy. Obviously, the proponents of cheap goods love this. They say it's wonderful that we have cheap goods in the country. But it's really a dead-end argument to say, let's have lots of cheap goods when you don't have the jobs to buy those goods. Illegal imports, whether they are, you know, the traditional ones or the secondhand clothing or the counterfeits, are an existential crisis for trying to industrialize a country and create jobs and decent work.
Are you saying then, Simon, that it's really the industry, as in the textile and the clothing industry in the country, that suffers because of a loss of jobs and because of the, competitive space that you find yourselves in? But as far as consumers are concerned, consumers are quite happy to be paying the cheaper prices. So is it a matter of us as South Africans saying, yes, we need to keep people working, yes, we need to maintain the integrity of the local manufacturing market, and so therefore we should sacrifice and pay more for goods that we can actually get cheaper?
Yeah, I don't think one can run away from that argument. There is an element of that argument which is true. which is, you know, there is a in development, there is a trade-off between having absolutely the cheapest products possible and the consequences of having cheap products. And so, yes, at some level, you know, the choice is between, do you have something that costs you R4.50, or do you pay a little bit more and create the jobs on the back end to create a citizenry who have spending power, who can use that spending power in the local economy to drive it, and eventually get into a virtuous cycle of development. So, you know, there is a narrow trade-off that exists there, but I wouldn't say that trade-off exists between the clothing and textile industry on one hand and consumers on the other. In fact, you know, I think it's far broader than that. So if a employee or a worker, a factory worker has a job, it's not just that they and their industry benefit, their household benefits, their community benefits. So there's a knock-on pro-social effect. If you look more broadly at what happens when the state manages to recover taxes, it doesn't just spend those on an industry, it spends those on a country. Your ability to spend that on industrialization or education or welfare or policing or whatever it is. So, you know, in a very, very narrow sense, there is a trade-off between an attention between consumer price and development broadly, but that tension bleeds into the rest of society, has fundamental consequences through the ecosystem of the rest of society.
As we wrap up our conversation this morning, I want to touch upon a point that you brought up, the fact that there are illegal imports that are coming through and they're not paying their taxes. Now, just recently in Gauteng, the police destroyed about 3 billion rands worth of counterfeit goods. But you, as Sakto, are saying, by the time these goods actually get onto the streets, it's way too late, that the ports are too porous. Talk to us about, I guess, the bottleneck at the ports. Why is it that these products are actually even making their way into the country?
So strategically, you're absolutely right. To try to solve the problem in the nexus of the rest of the country is a really difficult one. The best place to solve it is at the ports of entry. You squeeze the ability for them to enter the country. The challenge is that, as you say, the ports are porous, largely. Goods are coming in either declared as other products. You want to bring in a shoe, but you say it's a tin of tuna, for example. I mean, it's a bad example, but just to make the point. So you declare it as another product, which has a different level of tax or duty. Or maybe you smuggle it in. In fact, you say you bring in one shoe, but you bring in 6,000 shoes. It's various tricks like that which get it through the borders. And what we need to be doing is stopping far more products at the borders. So we've called for many, many years for SARS to increase its number of stoppages, to use different kinds of technology to increase the visibility of containers. To be fair to SARS, we are definitely seeing the rebuilding of an institution that was absolutely damaged in the period of the 2010s, the mid and late 2010s. We are absolutely seeing the rebuilding of it, and we celebrate it. But there's a lot more work to do.
Simon Eppel, we'll have to leave it at that for this morning. Thank you so much for your time and your insight. That's the South African Clothing and Textile Workers Union, Simon Eppel. I must say, Gareth, what I found quite interesting is something that we didn't have time to get into with Simon, but he said that the importation of secondhand goods is actually illegal, except in certain circumstances. Mm. I really didn't know that.
No, that's one of those, and that's where this whole issue becomes a bit of a grey area as well. It's not as clear as black and white, because there's a lot of sort of nuances in between all of it, where you've got to wonder, well, this is what we were asking last week, what is a counterfeit good? Mm. What are the regulations involved there? And that's exactly what I think a lot of people wouldn't actually know. So we're going to stay on that as well, because the point being made about employment down the line, if it's not counterfeit goods, but I suppose I can see the argument that low-income earners don't have the money to buy the authentic 1,000 rand pair of shoes, but they need shoes. You need shoes, and if you can get them for 100 rand, I can understand that side. It's not helping the problem, but I can see both sides.
And then there are also issues of IP,
and
the fact that you can't take two G's and, you know, stamp them onto a shoe, and all of a sudden you've got a big name brand.
Two G's, Gucci and Gabbana. No. How do
you say
no.
You know how the Gucci sometimes have the two G's?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
No, I don't know that.
Or the Louis Vuitton or whatever brand it is that you want.
You can
to
laugh at me. I'm not that fashionable.
No, neither am I, actually. Neither am I. But there you have it. We'll look into that story about the secondhand goods, because I do know in some countries, especially Ghana and the rest of the African continent, there's a huge market for secondhand goods. But apparently it's not legal in South Africa, except in certain situations. But we'll follow up on that in another time and in another space.